All right. Hey, hello everybody. Before we start with the talk, which Nicola offered to give, which is really cool, I want to give a quick update on the Zurich Friends of Haskell Association, which I've been talking about last time, Jasper as well. So the status there is that we have founded it. There's actually 6 people in the board. How many do we have here? We have Matthias back there, Jasper, myself. Jasper setting up the website, and we're gonna get the bank account next week. So the idea is that once we have it all set up and it's sort of really clear how what it is and sort of self-explanatory from the website, we'll send out an announcement mail through the Haskellers meetup, and you guys can then look at it, ask questions, join if you like. So it takes a bit longer than I was expecting last time, but still it's all in progress. We'll all happen. Another thing that I'm just curious about, who's actually going to join for Zurich Hack? There's still places free. We're now above 400 people that are signed up, but 500 is the limit, so feel free. Cool. Nicola?
Oh, hi everyone. Thanks for coming. It's very nice to have you here. I'm going to give a quick talk on interactive data exploration using Haskell, Nix, and I guess we're going to get started. Recording?
Let me check whether it's actually... Yes. All good.
All right. So this is going to be the program. I already want to apologize. I didn't manage to mirror the screen to mine, so every now and then I'll be showing you my back. It should be fine. So we're going to try and build a picture of what countries contribute most to Haskell. We're going to do that using Jupyter, which I'm going to talk about in a second. We're going to bootstrap all with Nix. Then we're going to discover what APIs, what data we can pull to run that analysis. And then we're going to use Haskell to pull data from those APIs. And finally, we're going to draw some charts and visualize it all. So, first, why though? Who wants to know that? So, I was in London for about a year. That's where I discovered Haskell, and there were lots of people in London using Haskell, so it was quite nice. And I moved back to Switzerland, and I had a drink with Jasper, actually. And Jasper was telling me, oh yeah, but you have this Haskeller here in Zurich, this Haskeller, this Haskeller. And the list kept getting bigger and bigger. And I was like, this is really weird, because in London, there was a lot of Haskell, okay, but it was also a really huge city, 8 million inhabitants, more than Switzerland. And I come back to Switzerland, and apparently there's just as many Haskellers. And I was like, there's something weird. I'm gonna check this out, like, figure out, is Switzerland really contributing so much to the Haskell community? Is Simon doing a good job or not?
That's a little nicer. You guys are doing it.
All right, so what is Jupyter? First of all, can everybody raise their hands? Or at least one? Everyone? All right, take your hand down if you've never used Haskell before, or if you have used Haskell before. All right, all the hands up. Down if you've used Haskell before, if you used Nix before, or Jupyter before. All right, you're in for a ride. Yeah. So lots of Haskellers, few Nix people, and I guess few people haven't heard of Jupyter or IPython before, so maybe not. So basically, Jupyter is a Python project that started, not sure when, but allows you to run a Python REPL, so read, eval, print loop, in a browser. So it's very nice. You can run all your Python code in your browser. After a while, they kind of opened the protocol and allowed people to write their own kernels. What that means is that you can use all the languages with the Jupyter infrastructure. So you have just a web server that serves the pages, and in the background, you have particular languages with kernels that just run the evaluation for those for stuff that you write in the notebook itself. I'm going to show an example in a second. So it's really cool because it supports Markdown and code. So you have those cells where you can write first, oh, this is my function, then you call the function. Then the next bit you say, well, this is going to be Markdown. And so it all looks good. You can bring it to your manager later on and tell them, like, this is what I did, and it all looks nice. The problem with Jupyter is that, well, you have Python involved, which means you need to have Python installed in your machine. Then you need to have a particular kernel installed. Then if you want to do PDF export, for instance, you need Pandoc installed. So as a matter of fact, I have none of these. I don't have Python. Oh, I have Python. I do not have GHC. I do not have the Haskell kernel for Jupyter, which we're going to use. So what's going to happen now? Well, this is where Nix comes into play. Nix is a functional programming language which is aimed at doing package management. By the way, the whole talk is going to be very interactive. So I'm going to be writing stuff in the console and writing stuff in the notebooks. If at any point you have questions or things you want me to try out on the screen, just raise your hand or ask me. So this is Nix. Can everyone see the screen, the characters? Yeah. Nix is really just a functional programming language. So here we have a map over a few numbers. Whoops. Very simple. But Nix also comes with a lot of infrastructure for doing package management. So one example is the packages from Nix packages. Nix packages is a repository of all packages that have been packaged with Nix. It's just a GitHub repository with some Nix code that explains how to build stuff. So what's really cool is that Nix has amazing reproducibility guarantees. Nix is a purely functional programming language. You have functions, the inputs of those functions are captured, so you can just look at every input, and whenever anything changes, it's going to produce a new package. So here we have Pandoc, for instance. And Pandoc evaluates to something, to some path in my system. Here in the middle, you see a long string of somewhat random numbers. These are the hashes of the inputs, so the hashes of everything that's been involved when creating Pandoc. And this is amazing because that means you can have lots of different versions of any packages installed in your system at the same time, and everything is going to be called in everything is going to be stored in what's called a Nix store. So, why does that matter to us today? Well, as I mentioned earlier, I do not have Python or anything installed, but I have what's called a Nix shell, which is just a Nix expression that's going to allow me to drop into a shell just for a few seconds, the equivalent of a one-night stand in Nix. And in that shell, I'm going to have everything I need to run the Jupyter kernel. Bam, Jupyter. There's a repository, which is hosted on GitHub and Matthias/countries, and it has the Nix shell. So that means that anybody on Linux can just clone the repository, run Nix shell, and you're gonna be able to run the notebook. I'd rather you do that after the talk than during the talk. But if you try it out and it doesn't work for you, beer is on me. If you're on Linux.
It won't work if the Nix package manager is not installed, isn't it?
Yes, of course. So you need Nix installed. So, this didn't work. There we go. This is the recipe for running the notebook. Now, I'm going to talk a bit about how we're going to get that data to map those countries and map their contributions to Haskell. So, what's the best way to get information about developers in general? GitHub. This is where all the open source developers and others are. And there's just a lot of data. You might not realize it, but almost everyone has a location associated with their GitHub profiles. So this is what we're going to use. GitHub also has a great discovery platform where you can just list all the Haskell projects. This is what we're going to use. So here, for instance, just topics Haskell, and GitHub gives us, oh, these are all the Haskell projects that we have. Oh, fine. Then, given a particular project, you can say, oh, this is cool. Yeah, not bad. Who's contributed to it? Ah, these are the people who contributed to it. This seems to be the top contributor, all right. Well, he lives in Minneapolis. And this is how we're going to fetch location information for all the users. Everything that we're going to do from now is going to be based on the data that we first got from GitHub. Any questions so far? All right. The biggest issue is that, well, this one says Minneapolis, but Minneapolis is not a country. It's a city. And some people write weird locations. Some people write countries, some people write cities. So we need a way to just make a big homogeneous blob of cities. The way we're going to do that is by using a different service. The different service is called GeoNames. Has anybody heard of GeoNames before? Really?
Sure.
All right. I had never seen it before. And I was trying to figure out a way to just map the countries, the cities, doing it myself. Just Google it up, and this came up. So this actually works very well. It's a very nice platform. So let me just give you an example. Earlier we had Joe Nelson from Minnesota, from Minneapolis, which is in Minnesota, I think. There we go. Just type in Minneapolis, gives us the country, feature class, whatever that is, and then gives us all the matches that he got. You can put a lot of stuff in there. So Zurich, for instance, Zurich country, Switzerland, fine. What's the street here? Remichstraße?
There's Zurich in Canada or something.
Sorry?
Isn't there a Zurich in Canada?
There is a Lake Zurich in Illinois.
Okay.
Yeah. Which, but, yeah. I came across all the weird subtleties of countries during this thing. There we go. Remichstraße, first thing that comes up is the University of Zurich. Why not the ETH? I don't know. Which is a shame, really. All right, so this is going to be our transformation platform from any kind of location to a country. So how we're going to go about this is, first we're going to ask GitHub to give us the top Haskell repositories, because we're mainly interested in Haskell. From those repositories, we're just going to fetch the contributors. It's going to give us Haskell users, or at least people who have written Haskell once in their life for a given repository. Then we're going to ask GitHub again, what is the location of that person? This might be Minneapolis, this might be Zurich, this might be a street, this might be just some complete garbage. But we don't have to care about this at all, because we're going to ask GeoName. We're going to ask GeoNames to give us the country code for a particular location. We can't always ask GeoNames to give us the country name for a particular location, because it doesn't always give it. If you ask for a country, it's going to give you other kind of data. But a country code is almost always there. And finally, with the country code, we're going to ask for the country name and the population. And this on the far right is the data we're going to use to map our results. So, a little bit of vocabulary first. We're going to be working with a lot of APIs, endpoints, query parameters. This is the URL. This, we don't care. No one knows what it is. This is the host. We're going to call this the host from now on. This is basically where the server is going to be serving us the results. This is the path, the results. And these are the query parameters that we send. So the path asks for a given resource. Query parameters usually just give hints to the server on what we want about the resource. And query parameters are split with those equal signs. It's usually a key and a value. Should be straightforward, right? All right. Now we're going to be looking at the actual APIs that we're going to use, that is GitHubs and GeoNemesis. So, GitHub has a really nice set of APIs. Who's used GitHub APIs before? 1, 2, 3, 4-ish. It's really sweet because they have nice documentation. Twitter also has nice documentation, and it'll make sense. GeoNames, as we'll see in a second, I had to fiddle a bit and like try and look at the results and try to make up what I was doing. But GitHub is really nice. So instead of showing you the whole page of the GitHub API, I just wrote down what it's gonna look like. So for repository, it's quite simple. We have the weird HTTPS stuff we don't care about. api.github.com is the host. search/repositories is the path. Cool. Takes two query parameters. Q, which is gonna be just a query form that they developed themselves. For now, we're just gonna use language Haskell, and we can specify a sort. So we can sort by stars, by newest, but in our case, stars is gonna do, it's gonna work fine. So, let's see if we can do it. Yeah, the github.com. And all right, got a huge blob back. Not very interesting.
Cool.
All right.
See. A bit more skew.
Perfect. Gonna use JQ to just print it in a nice colored way. JQ is just a JSON parser. Parses whatever we got back from GitHub and prints it with colors.
Right one long press on the ones.
For the camera, we're having light issues.
It's bright enough. It's spring. It's finally spring.
Yeah. Who would have thought? All right. This is the answer we get back from GitHub. So, we got a big JSON object with some items. And each item is a repository. As it turns out, the number one Haskell repository is Pandoc. Any questions so far? Oh, good, I guess most people.
How many items does it return?
It returns about 100 items per page. This is a parameter you can tweak. I can't remember what the default is, but later we'll set it to 100. 100 is the upper limit. Well, this is quite a lot. We have, yeah, I think this is the second item. Yeah, second item is Postgres, and we have quite a lot more stuff in there.
The first line is 74,000. If that was part of the question.
Yeah, so was your question about number of items it returns in a single call? Or the, okay, so in a single call it's about 100. But apparently there are 47,000 Haskell repositories, which I don't believe, right? Because there are about 100 Haskell users, so. All right. So, now we can do some JQ magic. Because we're only interested in the items, you can say, okay, just give me the items. That works. You can step into the items and finally get the full name of the repository. What happened? So JQ allows you to focus on a particular bit of your output. First we say, well, I want the whole output. Then we plug this very much like a shell pipe. And we say, well, I want the items. And for each item, this is basically just zooming inside the items, give me the full name of that item. The full name is the repo name with the username before that. These are apparently the most starred Haskell repositories. Lots of compilers, PureScript, Elm. I think there are a few people in the room using Haskell for compilers. Hopefully all those compilers are faster than GHC itself. All right, so it's kind of fun to just walk around in the shell, trying out the APIs. By the end of the day, what I want to do is Haskell. So let's do Haskell. This is Jupyter. This is the stuff I started earlier. And let's have some fun now. Let's first start with Python. This is the cell thing I mentioned, where you can have 1 + 2, for instance. Gives us 3, works. That's cool. You can add some cells. Def foo bar. And you can reference things from other cells and the subsequent cells. All right. Who cares about Python? Oh, no! All right. Do you mind if we switch to Haskell then? All right. Start a Haskell kernel. Bit slower, still it works. It is Haskell, then. Oops. Haskell, in a web browser. All right. Do you mind if I close the door, Simon?
No, 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 sorry.
So, I opened a notebook that I prepared earlier already, which is going to be the whole code for discovering the countries. It is evaluated, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell it to just restart and clear the outputs. So now we have a completely pristine notebook. And now we're going to try and repeat what we did in the shell, but using Haskell. For the API calls, well, there's HTTP client, which is the standard in Haskell. People use that, people like that. REC is amazing. It's another HTTP client. It's much simpler. It's much more like Python, Ruby, if you used that before. HTTP client is a bit more for savages. This is very much beginner friendly.
Does it build on HTTP client?
What does?
REC, doesn't it use HTTP client below?
Yes, I think so.
Who cares?
Yeah.
Right? It's the API, the interface that matters.
Yeah, sure. Well,
yeah.
Well, I care because it means that the trusted code base, so every improvement to HTTP client will be reflecting REC.
Yeah.
There's
other
libraries which are just like, I know it better.
No, not at all. Okay.
No engineering.
So REC is just, it was made by Brian O'Sullivan a few years back, and it's just a simple layer if you don't want to care too much about creating a TLS manager, that kind of stuff. It's just gonna work like, let's actually play with it for a bit. This is just get simple API call. What's a small, what do you mention? Hello.ch?
Take the one from GitHub? Oh yeah, okay.
And there we go. Much simpler than having to set up an HTTP client. So, back to the one from earlier. This is what we did in terminal earlier, and there we go. I captured the output in some variable called R, and the reason is that for big outputs, the Jupyter notebooks are not that great. So it all runs in a browser, so Chrome is gonna eat up all my memory. So let's not print everything out. Let's just do as we said earlier, or as we did earlier in terminal. Another cool tool that we're going to use now is Lens Asian. So it's a set of lenses that you can use if you don't want to write full-blown Asian instances. So lenses are simple accessors for bits of your data. I think it's just a Haskell thing. I don't know if it's used in any other languages.
It was cloned in Scala.
Yeah.
It
was cloned, okay.
There's Monaco.
There's a lesser clone in Scala. Right? All right. So, let's figure out what just happened. This is the response we got from the API call from earlier. Well, this weird operator that we're not going to focus too much on right now, but basically we're going to just ask it, well, what's the response body of the request, of the response? And then, as earlier, we'll look up the items of the API response. And then, just as we did with the JQ, so JQ has this thing where we just zoom in on the items. You're going to say, well, let's focus on each value one by one. And those values are the repositories. And for each repository, we're going to ask the full name. And one more thing here is tell it that we want a string. And there we get the 5 top Haskell repositories. We're going to be printing a lot of stuff, so I'm just going to write a little helper there. There we go. Questions about this?
So can you move the R get line once set up? Because I'm just getting...
Sorry.
I'm just getting a little bit strange feeling about the GitHub spelling. So if you just move the R arrow to a separate cell, then it will be a lot faster. Every iteration will be a lot faster.
Slowness was horrifying me.
Yeah.
There we go.
Thanks.
Let's make sure it actually works. Ah, oh, much faster.
And your IP won't be bad.
Yeah. Well, it's not my IP, it's Zimon's friend.
Some IP on ETH's public network. It's gonna be okay.
I'm lost with all my Chrome windows. There's one. Okay. We got the repositories now. Next one, once we've got the repositories, I'm gonna speed up a bit. So we can get the contributors of a particular repositories. The first repository we had was Pandoc. Then we can just throw this other API call, JGM Pandoc contributors. We're gonna get a list of logins. So for every user, we're gonna get the username. Then for a particular user, GitHub has yet another API endpoint. They can say, all right, we got this user, give me information about them. Particularly, we can ask for the location. Berkeley in that case. Then this is the geonames API. Simple as well. We say just search JSON. We give it a Q parameter, which is the location we want to search. And a username. So GeoNames has a demo account, but which is overloaded all the time. So I had to create my own GeoNames user. We're going to do the same for GitHub in a second. But in general, you can use demo unless you're doing a presentation, because things are going to break. Search JSON, gives you the country code that we wanted earlier. And then we ask for the country info. Once we have the country code, we pass that in. And it gives us the country name, United States, and the population. Wonderful. Let's see other maps to Haskell. This is my GeoNames username that I mentioned earlier, just written into a file. And that's about it for the API calls. So next up is the Haskell wrapping. We are not animals. We want to have types. We don't just want to be passing strings around. So the first thing that we want to do is create types for all these things. We had GitHub repos that were strings. We had users. User is just a string. Population is just an int. Okay, let's just create new types for all this. We have a GitHub repo, which is a text. GitHub user, a text. Country code, a text. Country name, a text. Fine. And here the country population, which is an int. For all of these, we're going to derive is string instances, so that we can just actually type a string, and it's going to create a GitHub repo for us. And likewise with the country population. For a whole country, though, what we're going to use is a country name and the country population. All right. Once we have these types, we can write some helpers for our creating URLs. The GitHub API is a string. GeoNames API is a string. These are just the hosts of GitHub and GeoNames. Then, for searching the repos or getting particular users of a repo, looking at the users. This is all we saw in the slides earlier, but written out once as a string. Any questions? Anything to move one cell up? All right. Evaluate that. If there's anything that's unclear in terms of Haskell syntax or that you think is not efficient, just raise your hand. It's a notebook. We can just modify stuff, rerun it, go back to it later.
Actually, the language progress, you're right there, not just for the cells, but for the whole rest.
Yeah, it's like a GHCI session. So where each cell is one evaluation. It might even be each line, I'm not sure. But so if, as we did earlier, I think here, we had R created now being in scope. And then the next cell can pick up on that R.
Right.
Same goes for the GHCI extensions. Very good question. Same for the imports, of course. All right, so now we're going to write some functions to actually access the data. First, finding the country code. So for a country code, what do we need? Well, we need the location. And then we're going to call the GeoNames API search, which we defined just earlier. Let's not care too much about this here. This is just to make sure that GeoNames didn't reply with an error, because GeoNames doesn't return a 500 for a server error or a 404 for 22. So we have to look, it always returns to 200. So we have to kind of make sure that they're not screwing us. And then we look at the response body, look at the key geonames, which is the list of geonames answers, pick the first one, because this is sorted by relevance, and get the country code. Instead of writing down the whole URL like we did earlier, language Haskell and sort equals star, we're going to make use of Rex support for query parameters. So here we say our query is going to be our location, and the username is the geonames username, which is very private and I don't want to show you. No offense. All right. Once we have the country code, we can ask geonames for the country itself using that other URL. And this time we're going to look up the field's country name. So perform the request, then look up response body, geonames first one, country name, and then geonames first one, population. And it's going to return our country that we had earlier. Quick reminder, country is the country name and country population. All good so far? Sun is setting, people are getting tired, it's fine. Should we actually try this out? Country code. Example of a country? Ah, we're going to be looking up the country code. We want a full-blown country name.
Schweiz.
German. Shall we try this? Not bad. Same goes for pretty much everything.
Sorry, quick question.
Yes.
Where did you bring in geonames username into scope?
I hid it so that you wouldn't see it.
So how can you hide stuff?
I'm just kidding. I just skipped over it.
Oh, you read it off.
Yeah.
Okay, it's cool.
Completely forgot to mention. Thank you very much. I write down to a file so that I don't have to type it out. And then while I'm giving the talk, you guys are just writing 1,000 requests and I get locked out of my account.
What? You don't trust us?
All right. And then indeed we can find the country by country code, CH, and I forgot to evaluate this. Switzerland, small country, not even 8 million inhabitants. All right. So just as I hit the geonames username in the file, I did the same with the GitHub API token. I'm going to read it now. There we go. And now we're going to be looking up some user's country. So we have the country to country code to country name and country population. Now, GitHub user country. So it's going to take a GitHub user's parameter and return a country. First, it's going to get the location. Fetch user is just calling the GitHub API users. Once we have the location, we're going to try and find the country code. And then the country by country code. And now, apparently Simon Mayo is from Switzerland.
Wait.
Anybody willing to guinea pig for this one?
MB21.
MB21. Switzerland as well. This is good. The more people we have here, the better the results are going to look. So, not everyone has a country associated to it. So when we look up a user country, we may have two failure scenarios. One is the GitHub user didn't set the location, and the second one is geonames not being able to give us an actual location based on the string. So for instance, is my coworker Andreas Hermann did not set a location. He's not with us today, and he sets his location to nothing when he's outside of Switzerland. Very thorough guy.
So this should be nowhere, not nothing.
No, he just doesn't have a location. I was kidding. Some people have really weird locations. So geonames usually works. Like everything you can give it returns something, even if it's in Lost Island in the middle of the Pacific. But there was one guy who had a very suggestive location, which was, where do you want me to be? Geoname just cropped up. I was like, I'm not dealing with this. This is your problem. Okay. So, we've done some Haskell wrapping. What's next? Who likes Conduit? One FP complete guy. Alright, Conduit is a very nice way in Haskell to abstract streams of values. So it's also a very nice way to modularize your processing so that basically you can have a resource. You might have a lot of... Let me rephrase this. Let me give an example rather. So conduits are little pieces of code they can just plug together. And it's never gonna run, it's never gonna fill up the pipeline at any point. It's gonna make sure that one element is processed at a time, which is gonna come in very handy here because we have lots of repositories that we pull from GitHub. And we don't really wanna care about like dealing with lists and passing the list along. So what we're gonna do is build a few conduits. The first one is gonna just give us GitHub repositories. Then, because GitHub might return us 100 repositories, as we discussed earlier, we only want to deal with one, and we're going to say, well, with this repository, I want the contributors. This is our second conduit. And then, next one's going to be, well, I have a user, right? Where'd they come from? And the final conduit is going to just give us the countries. And this is going to all fit together, we can plug it in various different ways. It's going to be wonderful, I'm going to show you.
Is the wrong country.
So, GitHub does pagination. Gives us n repositories at a time or n users at a time. So here, I wrote a little helper that's just going to iterate through all those pages of results. One great thing with rec, the library that we're using instead of HTTP client, is that it has almost built-in support for iterating over GitHub results. When GitHub returns 100 users, for instance, it's also going to give us a link and say, hey, you might be interested in the second page or the third page. Here's the link you need to follow to go to the next page. So this is just a loop. We're not going to focus on this too much because we're almost over time. And I'm just going to start showing the function signatures from now. We can find the top repos for a particular language, which is this conduit. This is the stuff I mentioned earlier. So conduits sometimes have weird names, in this case a producer. So this is the first conduit that we saw earlier. It's just going to produce results. It's just going to spit out GitHub repos. Internally, it might pull 100 at a time or 3,000. We don't care about that. It's just going to spit out GitHub repos one at a time. So did I evaluate everything so far? Yes, I did. So here we have the top repos, say for Haskell. We're gonna plug this into a different country. Conduit's gonna take a few and these funky operators here are how you plug conduits together. So conduits have special functions for saying, well, you plug these two together, but take only 5 results. I don't care about much more. And then this is just a map M over each of the results. And once again, we have our top 5 Haskell repositories. Can do the same with contributors. Give it a GitHub repository, and it produces that stream of GitHub users. So, repo contributors.
There's an N, repon.
Thank you very much. Take 5 once again. These are apparently the top 5 contributors. Should we try and do 10? That works as well. Small surprise here. All right. Now we have those 2 functions, one for grabbing the repositories and one from grabbing the users from a particular repository. But we can also plug them together. Top repos from Haskell, fine. Here, this function takes a GitHub repository as an argument, so we need to type onto it, hey, for every repository that you get from upstream, just plug this into the next function. So, await forever, contributors, and once again, take 5 and so, since we're still sticking to 5 users, we're still going to be within Pandoc. As we saw earlier, we had a take 5 here that was take 5 repositories, but in this case, it's take 5 users. We could write take, say, 1,000, 2,000. It's just going to keep pulling it. Whenever any of these bits is going to run out of contributors, for instance, you say take 1,000, there's not going to be any contributors left in Pandoc. I'm going to go one step up and say, oh, okay, let's give me the next repository. And then it's going to start feeding users there.
Can you show this? Not 1,000, but 100?
Yeah, sure.
I hope it suffices.
Yeah, so GitHub paginates 100 users at a time, so there you go.
Yeah, it's difficult to see when it switches.
So there's actually something very interesting there. If we put, okay, we're running out of time, but.
We have still half an hour.
So do I, have half an hour. No, but we're gonna come back to this later. But more interesting, so if we just keep getting contributors one at a time and then start counting countries and how many times they occur, well, you might have one person who contributed to Pandoc, and then to Postgres, and then to Shell Check, and then we're going to have the same country a few times. So what we're going to do is have another type of conduit, which is a sink. A sink means it's all the way to the right. So in our little Mario analogy from earlier, it would be a final conduit over there that just gathers things. So we had the producer all the way on the left, spits things out, and the one all the way to the right that just eats things. And then produces a result, but without passing things downstream. In this case, we're just going to loop over the values that are incoming. So we have this await function, which is from conduit. It says, all right, let's wait and see what comes next. If we have a next user, okay, let's see. We're going to have a set here, which is just a hash set. You're going to check that so far we've accumulated not too many users, and if indeed our set so far is not too big, then we're going to go insert the user in our set and then loop again. If for any reason either conduits not having anything left for us, or our city's too big, they're gonna say, let's stop here, and we're gonna return our accumulator, our set. So that at the end, we have at most, n different users. And this is what we're gonna use for checking the countries. So this is small functions for creating a conduit. And I'm gonna demonstrate and accumulate Unix. Do I have a typo somewhere?
Accumulate.
Accumulate.
Between M and L.
There's
a U.
Thank you very much. So, if we have three different items, this is fine. But say now we have twice the same item. Well, it returns a set, so we can only have one item once. But, oh, in the back, can you see the difference between the bars and the bar? Yeah. Now, if we have four items and some are duplicates, it's going to drop one of the duplicates and just return the set of all the items. And to clarify, it's not going to go further. So as soon as it has enough items, it's going to stop and return the set. All right. So because we're using a hash set, we need our users to be hashable, so to speak. Back to your question earlier about, or your question, I think, but does an extension, what's the scope? Well, what's really cool is that you don't have to care about this at all. You can just add stuff later on. And here, we're going to have these instances defined way below the user definition from above. And sweet. So.
But if you added it below, but used it above, it would have a very annoying evaluation model, right?
What do you mean? What's
so
the
if
example?
You referenced, like if you use that pragma above, you would have to evaluate your cell 40 before.
Yes, yes. But that would work. The things that you kind of have to keep a stack in your head of what has been evaluated in what order.
Yeah.
Most of the time, it doesn't matter. But every now and then, you're going to evaluate, especially a data type. Then evaluate the function that uses the data type, then modify the data type, and then create a data type, try to apply it to the function, the function is going to be like, I don't know, I was using data type from ages ago. So, we had, this is somewhat annoying, I'll just take it back to one, get some real estate back. I'm gonna copy this one here. Oops, way too far. And let's try this time to accumulate. This was copy-pasted from above. This is the top repositories from Haskell. We're gonna await forever and just pull the contributors from it. And then we're gonna say, I want five different contributors. In this case, it's a bit silly because Pandoc has over 200 contributors, so we're not gonna have two duplicated users in Pandoc. But this is the idea. Should we do another 10, just so we can see Mauro. All right. Now, at this point, I had a problem because the GitHub API was fine, gives us 100 repositories at a time, 100 users at a time. But GeoNames was very different. First of all, it's not ultra reliable, at least not as reliable as GitHub. And it's not as fast, because with GeoNames, we first look up the country code, and then we look up the population in country name. So for every single user, we have 2 requests. And if you have more than 100 users, it's not feasible, because that means that you have to spend 200 requests for a single set of 100 users. One request is 1 to 2 seconds, depends on the times of the day. So what we're going to do is we're going to bypass this whole thing. How we're going to do that is, I wrote a very simple cache. It's just going to cache stuff. How this works is not too important, but basically, instead of going and hitting geonames every time, we're just going to look it up in the cache first. If the user is there, it's going to give us a country back, and that's it. Uses LevelDB, which is a Google product, which is amazing. It's much simpler than LMDB, for instance, and it just works. You have 3 functions. One is open database, second one is get from database, and the third one is put. And it works with Haskell seamlessly. All right, we have our cache. Now, for a given set of, oh, questions so far? Forgot to ask.
I'm wondering, what are you caching?
I'm caching users. So we're gonna be pulling the repositories from GitHub, then the contributors. And for each of these contributors, whenever we wanna know where they are from, instead of hitting geonames, or first GitHub and then geonames, we're just going to look it up from the cache. So the cache is a big hash map that's persisted from GitHub username to a country.
So you could have also cached the geonames lookup, because you said that the GitHub API is fine, but the geonames is shit, so...
Yes, so the problem is that the GitHub is pretty fast, but still, for every user, we have to look up their location first.
Yeah, I mean both. So I don't mean instead. I mean you could have cached that too.
I cached that too.
Now,
it's from username to a country.
Yeah, but what I'm saying, if I work together with Simon in Zurich,
mm-hmm.
then you will still send 2 geonames to us, right?
2 times for Zurich.
Geonames is bypassed completely. I'm storing from users to the full-blown country. That means with country name and population. Shall we have a look, actually? So the scrolling is a bit messed up today. From now on, there's not going to be any geonames queries anymore. We cache the whole GitHub user country. The GitHub user country function was...
Would it still be, so this function requires a call to the GitHub user to find its location and a call to geonames to find that location's country. Is that correct?
This function, yes.
So if you have 2 users using the same location,
mm-hmm.
then you're still going to issue 2 requests for these locations.
I see, that was your question. Okay, yeah, of course. But it's very rare that 2 users have the... No, it's not very rare, but most of the time, one user is going to have Zurich, one user is going to have Zurich, comma, Switzerland, and so in that case, we'd have 2 hits, nevertheless. And the idea is that we cache on a very coarse-grained level, so that all these users, then we can reuse. If I have once a day have to leave my laptop for an hour just running and performing geonames requests, it's fine. Does that make sense?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, but we could have several layers of cache.
One question. Did we just get using this unique thing that we have unique users already? And if so, then that means that we don't need to cache anywhere, right?
It's more the interactive development.
Ah, okay, that makes sense.
Yes, very true. Yeah. So the idea is that you can just experiment with ideas without having to wait an hour every time. All right. We're getting to the last part, the visualization. This is the part where everyone wakes up because you're going to see pictures. No more Haskell, just pictures. I lied, by the way. On the meetup synopsis, I said I was going to use diagrams. I decided not to use diagrams because I discovered chart. Chart is much simpler.
It's built again on diagrams, isn't it?
No, not entirely. Oh. There are bits that are built in diagrams. I actually wanted to use diagrams and then use chart based on diagrams because then I wouldn't have lied. But it's not entirely based on diagrams. So, this is a charting function. It's going to take a title, a list of countries to double, and return what's called a renderable. Renderable, we don't care what it is, but the Jupyter notebook knows how to interpret that, which is good enough for me. Doing some imports here. And this is basically everything we've done so far. We set the language, which is Haskell, and a title. Let's just keep this in mind, doesn't matter too much. Pull the top repositories for that particular language, Haskell in our case. For each repository, get the contributors. And for each contributor, we're gonna fit this to our unique pipeline. And we want to accumulate 100 unique users. We're gonna store this in users. Then, we're gonna find the countries for all these users. So for every single user, it's gonna look it up from the cache. If it doesn't exist in the cache, then it's gonna go call GeoNames. I'll make sure that most users are in the cache, otherwise we're gonna be here until tomorrow morning. And then we're gonna chart. So, ready? Ta-ta-ta! USA did it again. Damn it!
But it's not proportional to the inhabitants.
Very interesting question. But nonetheless, we'll get to this. We'll get to this. United States, number one, of course. Surprisingly, Germany is next. I always thought Haskell was a very United Kingdom language, but fine. Switzerland, number four. Such a small country. You might be guessing where this is going. One thing that makes me very happy is I come from the French part of Switzerland. And whenever we get a chance, we like sticking it to the French. In this case, we have Switzerland, which is a tiny ass country. And we have France, which is a huge country. And they're all the way down the whole thing. I think there are some consultants from France, but I guess they mostly have remote people. Anyway, so, very interesting question. What about having it proportional to the countries? So here we built a chart which just takes a list of countries and doubles. And first, we get our countries, convert that to a list, which is a list from a list of country and number of Haskell in that country. Turn it into a list, then map the second element of these tuples so that we can convert our integer, which is the number of Haskellers, to a double that we can use. And then we're going to sort it such that it's going in decreasing order from the number of Haskellers in the country. So we can just copy paste this and do the same again, but this time making sure it's proportional to the size of the country. So where are we gonna do this? Let's just map it. So we have our country, number of Haskellers in the country, and we want the country and number of Haskellers divided by this is gonna work. I think so. Ha! Switzerland is number one. She's amazing, isn't it?
Are the first 100 users representative of the world?
Very good. So what's very interesting, I looked into this, I was like, oh, this is amazing. Switzerland is number one. Oh, my God. And I was like, oh, but surely Jasper must be in it, right? Because he's part of the 100 first Haskellers in the world. I'm like, yes, he is. And I was like, maybe Mauro is as well. Yeah, Mauro is as well. And I was like, am I in it as well, making my country proud? I was like, nope. Oh. Just think about what just happened. We have sourced 100 users. But what is 100 users? If we go to the... I can't type anymore. Contributors of Pandoc. How many contributors does Pandoc have? Pandoc has over 220 contributors. So basically, if you've never contributed to Pandoc, according to our metrics, you're not a good Haskeller at all. You don't even exist in the Haskell world. We have Mauro. We have Jasper all the way down here. And so what we've seen so far is basically, does Switzerland like Haskell? It's not sure. Switzerland likes Markdown, though. This is all the results we've had so far. So right before we leave, I suggest that we just run it with a few more users and see what happens. Geonames is a bit funny sometimes. So you pass it, for instance, York, which is an English city, and it goes back to New York instead. And I assume that some of that stuff is happening there. Another key thing to keep in mind is that some countries are very small. There is one country which is, I think, the US Mare Islands. According to Geonames, has 0 inhabitants. But according to Google, to GitHub, there is one developer living there, which messes up the results completely. Sorry?
Forever alone, that has
kind of... No, but he's infinity, right? Because there are no inhabitants. So this takes a bit because we're pulling a few pages from GitHub. Even though the users themselves are cached, the repositories are not cached, and the contributors are not cached. So also
it also doesn't really take into account how privacy-minded people are that they put in their location.
That is true, that is true. But it would be another project. We could do that, actually. So while this closes, do you guys have any questions so far?
When you derive the hash and eek side question, why is that not provided by generalized new type deriving? Like to use standard deriving? I don't know what
it is. It would be, but in that case, we would have had to do that with the type description, right? And when you write a notebook like this, you might not know ahead of time like what you're going to need. So I just wrote the minimal set of instances that I needed. And then as I went through, I just added more instances.
Okay.
But yeah. This might actually be piggybacking on generalized new type deriving.
We have to read help.
Ha! Wallis and Fortuna. What is that? French territory, 12,000 people. Yeah. So I'm going to suggest something else, is that we filter by country population first. And
just above 8 million.
All right, so here we're going to filter by...
Do we want to make a copy of the chart command? And at least we can reuse the users without recomputing it.
Yeah, very good. invite filter. I know, right?
Chalmers.
But they should do Erlang.
Sorry?
They should do Erlang papers.
They're not allowed to use Haskell.
So this is the final recipe I settled with. I was like, okay, this is about the best one. And I was so disappointed that Sweden was number one. Then I tried with a few other languages. And the only programming language I came up with where Switzerland was number one was...
Python.
Yes! I was hoping Scala, right? But no, Python. Apparently Switzerland loves Python more than anything.
So this is a research that you shouldn't have published.
Sorry?
You should have started again with a different hypothesis.
Yeah.
This is a research that you shouldn't have published.
Where could the US go? Or, I mean, this, you would expect that the region with lots of small countries, right? So
the US?
For instance, or, I mean, it nicely divides up between a couple of countries that each have a significant chunk, and then the rest is gone in this chart.
The chart is...
Oh, sorry, yeah, I limited this to... Where is the chart function? To 10 countries.
Ah, okay.
Otherwise, you have a few few countries with terrible weather here: Switzerland, Denmark, Norway, Finland, and then all the countries with the good weather, which are clanned together.
So have you run this before the 7000, and it's the same result?
No, only up to 3000. I'll be very willing to run it with 70,000. I just don't have the time. But you are very welcome to do it. All the results are there. We can actually, let's wrap this up officially. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Bottom line, the whole code is in GitHub. It's using the Nix shell, so you have one single command to run, and you can run with 70,000 people. My fear with 70,000 was that I don't know what GitHub gives us after we've run out of the 1,200 Haskellers that exist in the world. Any questions on the
overall? Where does the number come from?
Well, it was a study. I made it up. I have no idea.
I mean, the Haskell Ready base is quite a bit larger.
Pardon?
The Haskell Ready user base is already quite a bit larger.
Yeah, but
okay.
I'm logged in twice to upload my blog post twice. So. I assume other people do the
all
same.
Right, it's
no, that's right. I think it's 80,000.
What's your GitHub?
Oh. This is it. Enmatia/countries. So provided that you have Nix installed, you can just run the command. If it doesn't work, beer is on me. All right.
How tedious would it be to do it without Nix, just out of curiosity? So
it's a bit of a pain because you need... So the way Jupyter installs kernels is very simple. It's just one kernel is a JSON file that is stored somewhere. But then that gives a command. So you can do it with stack very easily. Stack install iHaskell, and iHaskell, which is the Haskell kernel, has a command to go and install itself somewhere else. That's fine. But then you need Python installed as well.
So there's a Jupyter tar.gc that you can just download for macOS or Linux. So only the Haskell kernel is the issue. If for all the Python and all the libraries and graphs and everything, there is on the Jupyter web page, there is a big binary tar.gc that you can just download and run.
Yeah, so Jupyter is used by many people, so it's rather easy. The problem is really Haskell, because even now that you have the iHaskell installed, the stack doesn't really allow you to have a custom set of packages. So then you need to stack install this, stack install that, and then iHaskell is going to piggyback on the global GHC user base. Maybe you can tweak it now with the extensible snapshots, Niklas?
I don't know.
You use Nix, don't you?
Shh. much, much easier to start with Nix, unless you're on the MacBook, but that should work as well.
I haven't tried it yet, so I can't tell.
Which one?
The extensible snapshot.
Ah, well, I tried it a few months back, it was broken.
No flame wars here.
Sorry?
No flame wars here.
Sorry.
So the Nix shell also contains all the Haskell libraries.
Yes. So.
And related to that, what if you notice during working on the notebook, you notice you need another library? Can you?
This was actually the primary reason why I wrote the cache, so that I could have something persisted. Because you have to kill the kernel, exit the shell, restart the shell, restart the kernel. By the time you restart the kernel, all the memory is lost too. So you need to re-pull the results.
Yeah, actually this is a negative of Nix, right? Because for a normal installation, you could just import another library after you install it. So this is a problem with Nix, but I'm not saying this is a huge negative. Just it's interesting that in the standard installation, maybe this would have worked.
No, not necessarily, because with stack, for instance, when you do stack exec iHaskell, for instance, stack builds a new database based on your package set. And
I mean,
Kubernetes. Oh.
And what's good?
No flame wars, sorry. Yes, maybe that would work.
But you would still have to quit the GHCI, right? Unless you want to manually try to load packages at runtime.
Yeah,
and
you
that
could
would
do
throw your state away, so I guess your cache there would still have, if you want to quit the GHCI. Okay.
Yes.
What would happen if there would be a repository with quotes or double quotes in its name? Would you count it correctly?
So my assumption was that since GitHub has all
of
their...
Course, yeah, or not, but what would happen?
I guess you get a JSON response back and the JSON has already escaped all that kind of weirdness.
Yeah, so actually as long as you use rec, REC is going to encode all your parameters. So far we've been using parameters like this. It's going to do the weird encoding. So it shouldn't be a problem at all. Wait.
Yeah, you
don't
use the REC.
Hmm?
Use the query parameter builder. So
yeah.
Yes, it's good.
Exactly. So if you do it like this, this is going to break. So if you just do map end, this is going to break. But if you... The scrolling is broken today. This is very annoying. Oh, god damn it. There, if you do parents like this, it should work.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't tried, but...
Can you use rec to output the URL that it built? Because then you're using
the response body, you mean?
If it's too high level, it doesn't print the URL, it just sends.
No, I'm pretty sure that rec has a command to print the concrete URL that's used, or the request that it would send.
So we can get the request object. I do not know. No idea.
Or we could just look at the doc for param. I think the good point is that you should use these.
Yeah, definitely.
Well-typed interfaces and not extremely tight programming.
Just to be a bit of a jerk, maybe, and the presentation was very nice, but I don't know if the idea was to also sell Jupyter. At the moment, in the presentation, it just looked like a glorified editor, and only at the end you get the pretty pictures. But I guess the whole idea of Jupyter is very nice because of the ability to mix in the markdown and all this kind of thing. And then you go over to somebody who doesn't really care about the Haskell, and they go, "Wow, look at all those pretty pictures."
If you want a really cool Jupyter notebook involving R and pictures, then I'd suggest Haskell R, which allows you to run Haskell. Well, it's just using Jupyter notebook, but inlines R in Haskell, and the demo notebook has a few nice pictures. So that would be another thing. But it's very true. I didn't make the most out of the Jupyter notebook.
So I have a half on topic, half off topic question for the whole audience and everyone. That I'm using Jupyter, but I pretty much don't like the representation format. That it's very GitHub, it's very Git unfriendly. And I have read that there are some projects which just represent the Jupyter notebook in plain text by some syntax that you have to learn how to separate the cells and everything like that. And my question is that anybody here uses any of that project? And if yes, then what is your opinion? Because I want to learn one. And I want to know which one is the best.
I have no opinion on that, I have no idea. Just showing, so basically the notebook is just a JSON file.
Yeah, and the problem with that is that you can defeat, you can't merge it if multiple people are working together. So there are this kind of Emacs-based projects for only text and then some magic, and I just wanted to know if anybody has some. Okay, thanks.
I'm guessing you could pre-process this, right? Whenever you commit, you have a commit hook that just splits it using JQ into several files. So one cell is a file. And then you reconstruct it. If you really want.
I think the question is about whether someone already did this. And is it usable?
Yeah, so there are multiple projects like this. I just, before I try each one of them, if anybody had an opinion, then I would be happy to hear it. But if not, it's fine.
In the R community, there is R Markdown, of course, which provides similar. There might be something similar,
yeah.
It might be a better idea just to use Markdown.
Yeah.
There are also a few other projects that allow you to work on more like new generation notebooks that allow you to mix different programming languages. Mm-hmm. You have many people work on the same workbook at the same time.
IPython Google Docs style.
Yeah, exactly. The same stuff like this where you can have cells with a Excel, Python, R, different people can work on it together. This is the future.
Who's behind that one?
Who's behind that one?
The Alpha Sheets?
Yeah, it's people in California. And it's completely written in Haskell.
That's what I remember, isn't it?
Yeah.
All right, cool. Thank you again. For the ones that
thank
are
you, everyone.
Interested, there is some space to serve in the pizzeria, as usual. And otherwise, see you in a month. Thanks for coming.